will be about Parkinson's disease. That has been fairly old disease, described more than 200 years back. And it's the second commonest neurodegenerative disease. So as with other webinars, this will be based on 10 points or 10 pearls. The first one, what's the difference between Parkinsonism and Parkinson's disease? What do these terms mean? Parkinsonism is the constellation or collection of these four clinical features: tremor, rigidity, akinesia, and postural instability. So you can remember these with the acronym TRAP. So in any disease with these four clinical features, it's called disease with the Parkinsonism. And where does the Parkinson disease fits in? So there are four broader types of diseases with Parkinsonism, and Parkinson disease is just one disease with Parkinsonism. In fact, it's the commonest disease. So my presentation would be based on this part, the Parkinson disease, and it's also called the idiopathic Parkinson disease. Other groups are hereditary Parkinsonism syndromes, where there are multiple neurological and non-neurological manifestations, where the Parkinsonism is just part of the whole clinical picture, and atypical Parkinsonisms, which has additional features apart from the typical Parkinsonism features, and the secondary Parkinsonism syndromes. It's important to remember or look for these secondary causes, as some of these can be treatable, such as normal pressure hydrocephalus. Second point, briefly about pathophysiology and pathology of Parkinson's disease. It's thought that the pathology and the pathophysiology is mainly centered around basal ganglia. So this is a coronal section of the brain, and basal ganglia are structures which are deep gray matter structures which consist of caudate nucleus, putamen, collectively known as the striatum, then globus pallidus, thalamus, subthalamic nucleus, and substantia nigra. The pathologies in these areas play a huge role in the process of Parkinson's disease. These basal ganglia structures are interconnected with each other with various pathways. And these two diagrams are a simplified version of that. On your left-hand side, you can see how they operate in a normal person. The excitatory pathways are mentioned in green, and inhibitory pathways are marked as red. So these basal ganglia structures ultimately give input to the thalamus, and there will be pathways from thalamus connecting the cortex. So there are two pathways from striatum to the thalamus. One is indirect and other one is direct. On your right hand side, you can see what happens in Parkinson's disease. In Parkinson's disease, indirect pathway is overactive and direct pathway is underactive. Ultimately, what happens is it causes excessive inhibitory input to the thalamus. In normal person, the thalamic pathway to the cortex is an excitatory pathway. However, in Parkinson's disease, because of the suppression of this excitatory thalamocortical pathway, there will be bradykinesia and rigidity and slowness of the movements. That's an oversimplified version of the pathophysiology of Parkinson's disease. Pathologically, in pathological specimens, there will be deep implantation, neuronal loss, and gliosis, particularly in the substantia nigra and brainstem nuclei. It's important to remember that approximately 60 to 80% of dopaminergic neurons are lost before the motor manifestations of the disease emerge. Lewy bodies, which are eosinophilic intracytoplasmic neuronal inclusion bodies, named after Frederick Lewy, constitute the pathological hallmark of the Parkinson's disease, and they contain alpha-synuclein. However, these are not specific for Parkinson's disease, because in other neurodegenerative syndromes also you get this alpha-synuclein with the Lewy bodies. Point three is about motor manifestations. Motor manifestations of Parkinson's disease are well known for over 200 years now. these are the cardinal, but there are two types of motor manifestations, cardinal and secondary. The cardinal motor manifestations are the features of Parkinsonism, tremor, rigidity, akinesia, and postural instability. I have put brackets there for the postural instability because it is not seen in early part of the Parkinson's disease. Tremor is one of the commonest symptom or sign in Parkinson's disease. It's predominantly a wrist tremor, most noticeable when the tremulous body part is supported by gravity and not engaged in purposeful activities. It usually starts unilaterally and then later on spreads to the other parts of the body or other side. It's typically described as a pill rolling tremor, as if the patient is rolling a coin or a pill in between his thumb and the index finger. And it's usually a pronation supination tremor. You can see the that in the video. These are typical Parkinson's disease tremor. It has a fairly low frequency, between 4 to 6 hertz, and it can involve legs, lips, jaw, and tongue, but rarely involves the head. A considerable proportion of the patients with Parkinson's disease has a postural tremor. For example, they can get a tremor when maintaining hands in outstretched posture. However, this postural tremor appears few seconds after assuming that posture. So that's called, this phenomenon is called the re-emergent tremor. And the Parkinson's disease tremor is exacerbated by distracting the patient, such as asking the patient to do mental calculations or higher tasks, then asking the patient to do voluntary repetitive movements of the contralateral limb, or anxiety, emotional excitement, or stressful situations. Bradykinesia is another cardinal motor feature of Parkinson's disease, which is described as slowness of movement. With there will be decrement in amplitude and speed as the movement goes along. And with the with these videos, you can see that it's asymmetric, and usually it's, it has a unilateral onset and remains asymmetric. On these videos, you can see the left hand is more involved than the right. The easiest way to check for the bradykinesia is to ask the patient to do repetitive alternating movements such as finger tapping, toe tapping, or pronation supination movements. And it's present at onset of the Parkinson's disease in approximately 80% of the patients, and later on it's seen in all the patients. It's important to remember that it's most difficult symptom for the patients to describe. They'll describe as various in various terms such as weakness, incoordination, or tiredness, or loss of fluency. So you have to be aware of that. Rigidity is another cardinal motor feature of Parkinson's disease. It's described as increased resistance to passive movement around the joint. Again, it begins unilaterally, typically on the same side as the tremor. There are two terms we usually use when describing the Parkinson's disease rigidity. Cogwheel rigidity is when they get a jerky or irregular pattern of resistance and relaxation. It's thought to be a manifestation of tremor superimposed on increased tone. And lead pipe rigidity is another term to describe the Parkinson's disease rigidity. It is the tonic resistance throughout the entire range of passive movement. That is in contrast to the class 5 rigidity of spasticity. You get in strokes and pyramidal tract disorders. For the completeness sake, I have mentioned postural instability in this presentation. However, it's very important to remember that this is not a feature of early Parkinson's disease. It's described as impairment in ability to recover one's balance, and patient report tripping on uneven surfaces, or sense of imbalance, or tendency to fall. Patients who fall early in the course of the illness most likely to have another Parkinsonian syndrome rather than Parkinson's disease, such as progressive supranuclear palsy or multiple system atrophy. This can be tested at the bedside with the pull test, where the examiner stands behind the patient and firmly pulls the patient by the shoulders. patient with normal posture reflexes should be able to maintain the balance and retropulse or move backwards no more than one or maximum two steps. However, patients with postural instability are likely to fall or take multiple steps backwards. In this video, you can see how a normal person and a patient with postural instability respond. Normal person moves just one step back. However, patient with postural instability takes multiple steps backwards, or even sometimes they can fall, if not hold. That's a very easy bedside test to check for the postural instability. There are a whole lot of secondary motor features of Parkinson's disease. Usually these are result of the cardinal motor manifestations. Predominantly tremor, these are the result of tremor and rigidity. They can have diminished arm swing, decreased blink rate, mask pace, which is called hypomimia, decreased voice volume, which is called hypophonia, then small handwriting, which is called micrographia, and striatal hand, which is the extension of the proximal and distal interphalangeal joints with flexion at the metacarpophalangeal joint. In addition, they can have difficulty in turning over the bed, difficulty in day-to-day activities such as buttoning clothes, tying shoelaces, double-clicking a computer, or typing. They can have dragging of the legs and taking shorter steps or stoops posture. Most of these features can be seen in even in early Parkinson's disease. Fourth point is about the non-motor manifestations of Parkinson's disease. Actually, for more than a century, it has been thought that Parkinson's disease is a purely a motor disease. However, over the last 20-30 years, there have been a lot of interest in the non-motor manifestations of the Parkinson's disease. There are a whole lot of non-motor manifestations which can be grouped into neuropsychiatric, cognitive, dysautonomia, sleep disorders, and sensory abnormalities. They can get depression, anxiety, or even psychosis, hallucinations, mood disorders. Then cognitive domains, they can have executive dysfunction or even frank dementia. They can have a whole lot of dysautonomia, sleep disorders like insomnia, excessive daytime sleepiness, etc. And sensory abnormalities such as pain, numbness, fatigue, and olfactory involvement. However, it's important to remember that some of these non-motor features occur very early in the disease course and some occur very late. For example, they get psychosis, hallucinations, and even memory loss and dementia. And most of the autonomic features except the constipation during a late phase of the disease. And there are four features for non-motor symptoms which occur even decades before the onset of the motor syndrome. These are called premotor symptoms. And these are all non-motor manifestations. They are constipation, anosmia, REM sleep behavior disorder, and depression and anxiety. These four features can happen years or even decades before the onset of the motor manifestations of the Parkinson's disease. REM sleep behavior disorder is where the patient try to act their dreams during their sleep. So they can have shouting or very violent behaviors, and they might injure themselves or even the bed partners. That is called the REM sleep behavior disorder. Fifth point is about the stages in Parkinson's disease. Now it's classified into broadly three phases: preclinical, prodromal, and clinical phase. Preclinical phase is where neurodegeneration begins but patient lacks clinical symptoms. Prodromal phase is where symptoms are present but insufficient to make a diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. And these during this phase, most symptoms or features are non-motor. They might have very subtle motor abnormalities, but predominantly it's a non-motor phase. And clinical phase is where Parkinsonian syndromes and the motor manifestations are present and readily recognizable. Once the motor manifestations occur, you can stage this with this commonly used HNY scale or Hoehn-Yah scale, where based on the severity, it's staged into five groups. Stage one is symptoms are very mild and only unilateral involvement. Stage two is bilateral involvement without impairment of balance. Stage three is bilateral disease with some postural instability. Stage four is severe disability, but still able to walk. And stage five is wheelchair bound or bed bound. Usually stage one and two is taken as early Parkinson's disease, and stage four and five is advanced Parkinson's disease. This is a classical Parkinson's disease timeline. The point I want to highlight is that the prodromal phase can span around 20 years before the motor manifestations of the Parkinson's disease occur. So they might have anosmia or hyposmia, or constipation, sleep, REM sleep behavior disorder, or depression for around 10-20 years before the onset of the motor manifestations. Ultimately, as the disease goes on with the onset of the motor manifestations, years or even decades later, they can be bedbound with having severe motor manifestations, difficulty in walking, and they might have significant cognitive and neuropsychiatric involvement with dementia and psychosis. So this is a progressive nature of the Parkinson's disease. Sixth point is, would the neuroimaging help in the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease? MRI is usually non-diagnostic in the evaluation of Parkinson's disease or idiopathic Parkinson's disease. However, it can be helpful in certain conditions to exclude any other structural abnormalities. And it might be helpful in certain instances where classical MRI features are found in atypical Parkinsonian syndrome, and Bimsarasa will do the next presentation about the atypical Parkinsonian syndromes, and we'll be dealing with that. And the other scan is the dopamine transporter SPECT scan, which is still not available in Sri Lanka. It can reliably distinguish between patients with neurodegenerative Parkinsonism from the controls and patients with essential tremor or drug-induced Parkinsonism patients. However, it cannot differentiate between among each other in patients with neurodegenerative Parkinson's. For example, it can't differentiate between a patient with Parkinson's disease and patient with progressive supranuclear palsy or multisystem atrophy. It usually measures the dopamine uptake. On top of this diagram, you can see the see how a normal patient would respond during the scan. And bottom, you can see how a patient with Parkinson's disease responds. There'll be a reduced dopamine uptake in the DAT scan in patients with Parkinson's disease or patient with neurodegenerative Parkinsonism. Seventh point is about diagnosing Parkinson's disease. It's very important to remember that diagnosis is essentially clinical. There's no blood test or a specific radiological investigation to diagnose idiopathic Parkinson's disease. There are two criteria which can be helpful. These are meant for research and even for clinical purposes. One is the UK Parkinson's Disease Society Brain Bank Clinical Diagnostic Criteria, which is fairly old one. And recently in 2015, International Movement Disorder Society has come up with the MDS Clinical Diagnostic Criteria for Parkinson's Disease. Both of these criteria go by the same principle with subtle differences. Number one is establishing, first of all, you should establish the Parkinsonism. For that, the patient should have bradykinesia with either tremor or rigidity. Earlier diagnostic criteria use postural instability. However, with the later ones, postural instability is not required to diagnose established Parkinsonism, because we know that it's a later manifestation of idiopathic Parkinson's disease. After establishing Parkinsonism, we should look for supportive features which would support the diagnosis of idiopathic Parkinson's disease. they are rest tremor, unilateral onset, asymmetry, levodopa responsiveness, levodopa induced chorea or dyskinesia, and olfactory loss. Those would be very supportive of a diagnosis of idiopathic Parkinson's disease. Then we should look for absolute exclusion criteria, such as cerebellar signs, downward supranuclear gaze palsy, or Parkinsonism limited to lower limbs for more than 3 years, dementia, or especially frontal type dementia within 5 years, cortical sensory loss, or history of neuroleptic treatment, or absence of levodopa responsive. So if any of these are present, you can't diagnose idiopathic Parkinson disease in a patient because most likely they have another Parkinsonian syndrome. And number four is we have to look for the red flags. You should be very cautious giving a diagnosis of idiopathic Parkinson disease if these patients have any of these features. They are wheelchair bound within 5 years or severe bulbar dysfunction within 5 years, absence of progression, inspiratory, respiratory dysfunction such as stridor, or severe autonomic dysfunction within 3 years, or bilateral symmetrical Parkinsonism, recurrent falls within 3 years, or absence of non-motor features despite 5 years of disease duration. So if a patient has any of these, most likely the patient have something else other than the idiopathic Parkinson disease. So the latest criteria, the Movement Disorder Society criteria, has come up with the exact time frames for these features. For example, wheelchair bound within 5 years, falls within 3 years, like that. So 8 point is about differential diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. There's a whole lot of differential diagnosis, broadly tremor disorders and the atypical Parkinsonian syndromes and the secondary Parkinsonian syndromes. Essential tremor is one differential diagnosis for especially tremor predominant Parkinson's disease. You can see the difference between the essential tremor and the Parkinsonian tremor. The most important features are essential tremor is usually bilateral, symmetrical, and Parkinson's tremor is asymmetric or initially unilateral. Parkinsonian tremor has a low frequency, 4 to 6 hertz like, and essential tremor has fairly high frequency, 6 to 12. And Parkinsonian tremor is a rest tremor, and it's typically a pronation supination tremor. Essential tremor is usually postural or action postural tremor with the flexion extension quality. So those are the features which are very helpful in differentiating between the essential tremor and Parkinson disease tremor. In addition, essential tremor patients can have a family history. Around 50% of the patient will report a family history. So that is also another helpful feature. Distribution-wise, Parkinson disease tremor can involve hands, legs, chin, or tongue. And essential tremor, similarly, hands can involve, voice can be involved. However, head tremor is more prominent in essential tremor rather than the Parkinson disease tremor. Dystonic tremor is usually you can differentiate with the distribution of the tremor. A dystonic tremor usually occurs with the dystonia. And usually they are jerky and irregular in nature. And the distribution is slightly different to the Parkinson's disease tremor, where you get the tremor is involved only in the parts with the dystonia. And if a patient has visual hallucinations, fluctuating cognition, or early dementia, we must think of dementia with Lewy bodies. Then multisystem atrophy patients will have early dysautonomy features, cerebellar involvement, or even pyramidal sign. And corticobasal syndrome patients will have dystonia, focal myoclonus, ideomotor apraxia or apraxic manifestations, then cortical sensory loss, alien limb phenomenon, or cognitive impairment. Then patients with early disturbance of gait with early falls, supranuclear vertical gaze palsies, early bulbar involvement, severe axial rigidity, early frontal cognitive involvement, we need to think of progressive supranuclear palsy. Normal pressure hydrocephalus can be detected on normal CT scan. In addition, clinically, they might have memory impairment and cogwheel, memory impairment with urinary incontinence as early features. And there'll be significant gait instability. Vascular Parkinsonism is also, CT would be helpful. And the Parkinsonism would be predominantly affect lower limbs. And drug-induced Parkinsonism, we can detect from the history. And you have to think of functional or psychogenic Parkinsonism features, Parkinsonism syndromes, if a patient has very inconsistent symptomatology, inconsistent or variable symptoms, then we must think of psychogenic Parkinsonism. So the ninth point is about treatment of early Parkinson's disease. In fact, the Parkinson's disease is the neurodegenerative disease which has most number of therapeutic options. It's based on dopamine replacement strategy to improve disease symptoms. And treatment is symptomatic in nature, and they do not appear to slow down the natural course of the disease. That's very important to remember and to inform the patient as well. And still, there are no neuroprotective therapies available. When a patient comes with Parkinsonism syndrome or idiopathic Parkinson disease, it's very important to determine whether symptoms are bothersome enough to warrant treatment to that patient. However, if the patient needs treatment and if the symptoms are affecting his day-to-day activities, there's no point of withholding treatment, and in that case, we should start treatment. So, what are the therapeutic options or pharmacological options available? Broadly, there are six groups. Levodopa, which is the most effective drug still available for the Parkinson's disease, that would usually replace the dopamine. Then a dopamine agonist, that would stimulate the dopamine receptor. Then monoamine oxidase B inhibitors and COMT inhibitors, catecholamine transferase inhibitors, they would increase the availability of intrinsic dopamine or levodopa. And anticholinergic and amantadine, also helpful in certain patients with Parkinson's disease. Dopamine agonist, monoamine oxidase B inhibitors, anticholinergic medications may be started in patients with Parkinson's disease who are younger than 65 or even 70 with mild to moderate symptoms. However, non-levodopa medications eventually will be insufficient, and there will be a point where you will be compelled to start levodopa because still it's the most effective treatment. And treatment of younger patients with levodopa should be considered if symptoms are bothersome enough to cause suffering. And so it should be considered even in the diagnosis if the symptoms are too bothersome. And exercise should be encouraged in all patients with Parkinson's disease. Final point, how to follow up a patient with Parkinson's disease. There's an internationally accepted disease rating scale, which is called Unified Parkinson Disease Rating Scale, UPDRS, which is specially made for the research purposes to assess the severity and to follow up the patients. It consists four broader categories: non-motor aspects of daily living, the motor aspects of daily living, how the non-motor and motor manifestations affect day-to-day living, then motor examination and motor complications. Which is very important in later stage. So, however, in a busy clinic, you can't be applying this UPDRS scale for each and every patient because this is meant for the research purposes as well. However, these principles still apply. Even within few minutes, we have to ask from the patients when the Parkinson's disease patients come for the follow-up. How the non-motor features are affecting their day-to-day life and motor aspects of day-to-day life, then we should examine for the progression of the motor manifestations And in later stage, we should inquire about the motor complications, which is an intrinsic part of the disease progression and the treatment. So that would conclude the 10 points. If I am to summarize the 10 points or take home messages, Parkinsonism is a constellation of clinical features, and the other Parkinson's disease is only one entity with Parkinson's. Parkinson's disease is caused by dopamine depletion in basal ganglia, and Lewy bodies constitute the pathologic hallmark. Number three, Parkinson's disease has cardinal and secondary motor manifestations. Number four, series of non-motor manifestations are involved in Parkinson's disease, and some begin before the motor manifestations. And number five, broadly, there are three stages, preclinical, prodromal, and clinical stage. This preclinical and prodromal stage can span for around 20 years before the onset of the clinical stage. And number six, MRI is non-diagnostic. However, dopamine transporter scan is helpful in differentiating neurodegenerative Parkinsonism syndromes from others. Number seven, diagnosis is clinical and based on defining Parkinsonism, considering exclusion criteria and supportive features and the red flags. There's wide different number eight, there's wide differential diagnosis. Most important and difficult be atypical Parkinsonian syndromes. Number nine is treatment is supportive, and levodopa is most effective pharmacologic agent. And when a patient requires levodopa, we should not hesitate to start. Number 10, there's a widely accepted rating scale to assess the progression of the disease. However, the principles, non-motor and motor aspects of daily living, then motor examination and motor complications are useful in day-to-day clinic follow-up in patients with Parkinson's disease.